Okay, so hello to everyone and welcome to Modern Magic Tricks using sound waves and holography to levitate objects with Professor Sri Subramanian. My name is Sam Stockdale. I'm the Senior Communications and Marketing Manager at UCL Computer Science. And I'm also joined here by my colleague Gia. She's in the background and she'll be hosting the Q&A session at the end. So this is part of the Faculty of Engineering Spring into STEM lecture series, and that's been running over the next few weeks, and we've got a range of other events in the series as well. So feel free to check out the other ones we have coming up. Just in terms of housekeeping of this event, it is being recorded and the session will be available online in a few weeks. So the session will be about 15 to 20 minutes long. And then we'll have about 10 minutes at the end for Q&A. So if you have any questions, then please do put your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And if you have any issues with sound or anything like that, then please just put it in the chat and we can try and help. So I think that's mostly all of the housekeeping. I'm very happy to hand you over to Professor Subramanian, who's going to take you through this fascinating lecture. So thank you, over to you, Sri.
Oh, thank you so much, Sam. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this session of Spring into STEM. Today's session is going to be about holography and how we can use acoustic holography to levitate objects. Now, as many of you know, one of the most rudimentary skills of any wizard is levitation, or to make objects fly. So how can we do that, right? I mean, here's an example of us in our own way, managing to do some levitation. So you can see this. So we picked up a little polystyrene bead and we're able to move that. It's untethered. And then we can move it around in different ways. Now, I don't know about all of you, and I know many of you are Harry Potter fans, but I grew up in an age where Star Wars was the big movie of the time, right? It was not so much Wingardium Leviosa, but it was much more about Princess Leia and the hologram that she was generating. And it turns out that we can do similar holography and holographic volumetric displays using levitation. So here's a small video of what we did. So here's, I'll just play it. So it's nothing but a polystyrene bead that you saw in that video content. And we can float this polystyrene bead in midair and do some really fascinating tricks with it. So everything that I'm talking to you about today is using ultrasound. That's sound that is just outside the audible range, 40 kilohertz to be precise. And now if we have a single transducer and we turn it on, it's going to emit a spherical wavefront that's going to disperse everywhere. But if I have, and it has a couple of important features, right? So that it's useful as background. Let's imagine this is your wave that's propagating through time. That's what we call the amplitude of the wave. And that's the wavelength, right? So when I say 40 kilohertz, what I mean is there are 40,000 waves in every second. Now, if I have many such transducers, and if I turn them all on, it's just going to be a jumble of some complicated wave patterns, right? But we can turn them on and off at different time intervals and time them carefully so that we create different patterns. Now, this time difference between different waves is related to another feature that we call the phase, right? So this phase is the time difference between two successive waves, or waves with a particular reference. And by manipulating just this entity phase, we can generate fascinating patterns, right? So what you saw here, this kind of a pattern here as a focal point, we can generate such focal points. Now, if you want to do levitation, actually turns out it's very simple. Right? You can try this at home if you want. Take two transducers, turn them on, or even take one of them and point it at a wall. You're going to have a wave pattern like this, where the wave goes forward and it comes back. And those nodes which are the points where they both the waves intersect and cancel each other out, and the anti-nodes where there's waves that are going in opposite directions. So those nodes are places where actually you can levitate objects, so they can they will hold their location there. So here's a simple picture of 16 transducers we use in the bottom and in the top, and then we can have a polystyrene bead in the middle. Now, here is actually not one, but we have 36 polystyrene beads that we are able to move them up and down, left and right. Okay, so this is a very simple levitation, right? So all we do is we float the polystyrene beads in the nodes of the sound wave. But we are not limited to polystyrene beads by any means. We can do other things as well. So here we have a small coffee bean. I like my coffee with water. So, it's nice to drink the coffee, not just eat it. So this some people call this coffee. You may like your coffee with milk. And there we levitate some milk. Maybe you don't just want coffee. Maybe you want some coffee with a little bit of meat, lettuce, bread. Some people call that a burger. So you can have a mini burger if you've not had your lunch with coffee. So we can levitate all kinds of different patterns. Now, what is it that we do when we do levitation? Right, I told you that we are levitating them in nodes, and we can generate these nodes and antinodes. But I also showed you really complicated patterns out there. So actually, what we're doing with sound is we are pinching the sound, like in this picture. So it's coming right all together. All the sound waves are coming together, and then the polystyrene bead is being held in that location. So what that means is a particle is trapped by sound. Now, a trap is a point towards which the forces converge in all directions. So they all come in this point. Now, that's sufficient. We don't need to do anything else. If you can generate those forces, then the particle will stay in that trap. However, that trap is not stable. It's only stable if the pressure amplitude is also minimum. That means that the particle is in a local minima, and then it doesn't jump out, okay? That's what levitation, that's what causes a particle to be trapped by sound, and that's levitation. We can now set this up as a computational optimization problem. That's where the holographic techniques come into play. And then what we're trying to do is we're trying to find amplitudes and phases for the different transducers that will generate that kind of a sound pattern. So if you imagine that there's transducer boards that are 256 of them, so that's below and 256 above. The question we are asking is, what is the amplitude and phase of each of these transducers that will generate a focal point somewhere in 3D space? So I'm going to give a location, and I'm going to find out how to do, what should be the transducer amplitudes and phase to do that. So I'm not going to tell you how we do that. I mean, probably that's a bit too much for the moment. However, if we do that, and then we try to visualize what the phases of those transducers look like, this is what we get, right? So we get actually three different types of solutions. That means there are three different, or many more than three, but here are three different solutions that will lead to levitation of of a single particle. We've labeled them as twin, vortex, and bottle. I will explain why we call them that in a bit. But what you're seeing here, these different colors are the different phases of the transducers. And the amplitude of the transducers are always one. That means we just turn them all on all the time. And the only thing we change is the timing between the different transducers. Now, this seems to be random and a bit chaotic, right? I mean, you don't really see any pattern here. But actually, there's a little trick we can do. So what we do is that if we separate this pattern into this signature and then this focal point, this is what I was talking about, like bringing all the waves together to a single point. That's the focus, right? And then you can apply this signature, which is a twin, because there's, you know, there's a left and a right, and then there's a section in the middle. So it's actually exactly out of phase, these two. So one of them is minus pi, the other is pi. or like a vortex, you can see like this, where it's a vortex type structure, and this is a bottle structure. So that's why we call them twin vortex and bottle. Now, what I'm saying here is that you can compute this focal point. You don't need to do this fancy optimization. You can simply compute this focal point, and you can apply the signature to it. Now, it turns out computing this focal point is really, really fast and easy to do. So a GPU can do it 40,000 times a second, even more. And what we did is we programmed an FPGA to do that. And then we added this signature, this twin trap signature to it. When we do that, we can go really, really fast. So fast that you can see something like this. So that's a single polystyrene bead that's moving at 40,000 updates per second. Okay, I'm going to stop it there. So what I showed you in that video, which you also saw at the beginning, is a single polystyrene bead or a single particle moving very fast. And the patterns you saw were generated by this particle moving, tracing the path that it needed to trace. But what if I want to have two particles? Like, let's imagine not one smiley face, but two smiley faces. Or if I want to do many complicated patterns, right? So all the things that I've told you so far only work if you're doing a single particle, right? It turns out that there are many, many algorithms in holography that allow you to do the computation of phase patterns that will generate these complex patterns. Now, whenever we want to do levitation, we will compute that phase pattern for generating the focal point in this point, and then add the twin trap signature to it. That's then you can get levitation. So here's the very old technique from 1972 that talks about how to do how to compute the phase map for the bottom transducers. If you're given a complicated amplitude field, right? So I'm not going to really explain what this is. I just want to tell you that what it involves is you start with amplitudes that are given to you, and then you randomly assign some phase to that amplitude. Then you do a Fourier transform, and the Fourier transform is actually called an angular spectrum method here. That will give you some amplitude and phase at the source. You discard the amplitude because we want to always turn the transducers on. So we only keep the phase. Then we do an inverse Fourier transform. So we go back to the target plane and then we keep repeating this cycle over and over again until we are happy with the quality of this field that's generated compared to the one that's given here. Okay, so we do comparison to see whether we're happy with it. And if you're happy, then we say that that's the solution that we want. Once we do this, we can then generate many. So you can see over here, actually, that we have a different particle, one polystyrene bead that's moving. And we have two polystyrene beads here. And And we can do other things, right? We're not limited to polystyrene beads. Now look here, what we have is many particles. We have five of them that we move together. Yeah. Now, I've been telling you the story about how we can levitate particles and so on, but actually there's another part to the story, right? Which is what we're levitating, what we're generating is sound waves, pressure waves. And in fact, if you put your hand in front of the pressure wave, you can also feel the tactile sensations. So it will feel as if something is hitting your hand and it's vibrating. So this can also have applications in, many other sectors, right? So so that's another additional aspect of generating acoustic holography, that it can be used as a 3D display, it can be used as a haptic device, it can be used for directional audio, it can be used for levitating food. So in fact, we've done this in restaurants, where we've levitated food in restaurants. The opportunities are plenty for holography and how holography can be used to levitate objects. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them.
Thank you, Sri. That was really interesting. As Sri's mentioned, if anyone's got any questions, please do add it to the Q&A or raise your hand and let us know. So we have one question here. Yep. Are there limits on the mass of objects you could levitate?
Are there limits on the mass of... it's a very good question. Yes. There are limits on the mass of the object we can levitate, but it's more useful to think not in terms of mass, but in terms of density. With mass, you also have volume. How big is the object? And usually there are limits on how big the object can be. So in all the videos that I showed, the size of the polystyrene bead is less than the wavelength of sound. So we use 40 kilohertz sound waves, which is 8 millimeters wavelength. So typically the polystyrene beads we use are 4 millimeters in diameter. If we add to that the density, so typically we can levitate objects which are 1 gram per cc, which is like water, to 1.5, 1.4 grams per cc or thereabouts. We've also levitated zirconian crystal once, but that was a special instance, and that's 4 grams per cc, so it's quite a dense object. There are limits on what we can levitate, but I hope that gives you an idea.
Thank you. Another question that someone's put in the chat is, what about the resolution? How high is the resolution?
A very good question. So it really depends on what we mean by resolution here, right? So I can move the polystyrene bead in sub-micrometer precision. And then if you talk about tactile sensations, then I can still create the tactile sensations and move them with sub-micrometer precision. However, people are not going to be able to feel those sensations because it's too precise for anyone to notice. So I don't have a very simple answer for what is the resolution of the device. Because the notion of resolution itself is challenging, and we need to think about what does it mean, resolution in this particular context, and before we can answer the question. So it's not that easy.
Okay, thank you. And another question that's been entered is, could you explain a little bit more on how you can make the bead move? Does it move from one node to another?
I used nodes and antinodes to explain simple instances of a single particle. So if you want to simply move one particle, you could move or displace the node, right? So if you have a pair of transducers that are on the top and the bottom, and then and adjacent to that another pair of transducers, you can offset them so that the bead can jump from one to the other. So that's the way you can move a simple polystyrene bead. However, if you want to have more complex movement patterns, then the simplest way to do that would be to create focal points nearby and update the position or update the phases of the transducers so that they generate a new focal point. Then the bead will automatically move to the second focal point, as long as the distance is not too far. The reason it does that is actually what's happening is that, like I said, all the pressure points are coming towards one another. So it's the particles pinched. And so you can think of it as sitting in a valley, right? And when I move the focal point and the focal point is not too far away, then I'm slightly displacing the valley. And then the particle continues to move down into the bottom of that valley. So that's how you actually update the movement of the particle.
Thank you very much. Somebody else put something in here. Thank you for such an informative and interesting session. I just wanted to understand more about the real world practical applications of this technology. For instance, we can levitate food particles, but how do we see it as actually being useful for the end user? This is coming from someone in HCI, which is our human-computer interaction area.
Yeah, again, great question. So usefulness for end user is going to come from how the technology is deployed and used in the particular context. So in terms of food levitation, so it was part of a restaurant that was particularly what was it? So the restaurant was themed after the Batman theme park, and I think it's somewhere in London, and it's an invitation only restaurant. So lots of they invite people over there, and they have a Batman experience, which included the levitated food. The other use of the technology is, I'm showing here in theme parks, they're used Legoland and many other places. These as a user interface, not just the levitation part, but the haptic side. The levitation part also has implications in acoustic printing. So people have talked about how you can use it for printing. And as a display device, right? So what I showed you as a holographic display. So it's still early days for us to deploy the technology in a real world context as a display, which can be used, and then we can ask people whether it's useful or not. The technology is not at the state where it can be deployed for those kind of Q&A. But yes, we are hopeful that we will get to that point soon.
Thank you. I think there's one more that came in. Could the same thing be done with light waves?
Yes, of course, the same thing can be done with light wave, but there's a big difference between light and sound, which is the energy that the wave carries. Sound waves carry a lot more energy with them. And so it's easier to do these manipulations with sound wave. It's a mechanical wave. Light wave doesn't have that amount of energy, but it has a lot more precision. You know, you talk about optical waves, which have a much different wavelength than typical acoustic waves. So the precision with which you can manipulate is much more. And in fact, the 3D display techniques that I showed you has been applied using optics as well. So optical holography and optical tweezers are a well-established discipline.
Thank you. If there are no more questions, we might bring this to a close. But Sri, I was just wondering, is there a link or somewhere we can share for people who want to know a bit more information?
So I guess a link to our website. There will be more information about what the group does and all the other aspects of multisensory devices, including levitation.
Okay, I'll share that in the link.
Yeah, we can post that in the chat. I think if there are no more questions, then we'll draw the session to a close. A massive thank you to you, Sri, for a really fascinating session. And thank you to everyone who offered really interesting and thought-provoking questions. So thank you very much. I think the link is now in the chat if you want to find out further information. And hope to see you soon at another Spring and Decem lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sam and Maria. See you all. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.